Welcome, everybody, to tonight's Board of Education meeting, Thursday, October 20th, 2016. Mrs. Rucker, tonight's our roll call.
Ms. Hunt?
Here.
Mr. Morrison?
Here.
Mr. Bannon?
Here.
Mr. Taylor?
Here.
And Ms. Arnold will be absent, but in all form.
Great. Joel, please join me in the pledge.
To the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, and I'm turning this over to Mr. Rucker.
Thank you, Mrs. Rucker. We have two presentations this evening, and the first one is our school spotlight. This will be our second one that we've done for the year. And this school spotlight's going to be on Valley Elementary, so at this time, I'd like to introduce our principal at Valley, Mr. Dan Schwederman.
Good evening. I have a great privilege of, you know, kind of spotlighting one thing that, you know, I think really is something unique to Valley and that we've really enjoyed and embraced, you know, since the middle of last year. When Mr. Houghton had said, you know, we'd like to, you know, start the school spotlight, you know, something that, you know, is unique to your school or is going well at your school. The first thing that came to mind was, you know, how our IMC really has kind of changed the way that kids look at the IMC, what they do in the IMC. They're, you know, very excited about it, and there's so many wonderful things that have, you know, that have been going on since last January. Ms. Cisitani, she was lucky enough to, I met her last December, and we had a great conversation the first time that we met. You know, she's very passionate about, you know, just having kids as lifelong learners and challenging them and having them, you know, do things outside the box, and it's, you know, in the frame of the IMC rather than just the classroom. Really gives kids a chance to shine, which is just fantastic. You know, I remember her asking me, you know, one of the first things she asked me was, you know, what do you want the IMC to look like? And I told her, I said, I really feel that, you know, the IMC is right in the center of the school, that, you know, a lot of things go in and out of the IMC. It kind of is our, you know, heartbeat, kind of in the, you know, for the school. And she, you know, was very excited about that, and she's embraced that, and I couldn't even imagine what was to come, but we're very lucky. So I'd like to introduce Ms. Stacy.
It was a heartbeat a little bit. Hi, I'm Stacy, and a little bit about myself. I came from Greene County. I'm a real librarian. I have a master's degree in library and information science. I was a librarian at Greene County for 2 years. I started out on the bookmobile. Yes, me the midget, drove a 40-foot box of books around. I loved it. We got to go to all kinds of schools in Greene County, and it was really a lot of fun. Then I moved myself up to Beldrick. I was the young adult librarian there, and I loved it. I love working with kids. And before I was a librarian, I was in the Army for 7 years in Intel. So this has been like a long and circuitous road for me, but I am one of the lucky people in this world who can say that she does her passion. This is my passion, this is my love, this is my jam. And your kids can attest to that, right? I see you smile. So, I have some slides I'd like to show you. I'm also a newfangled librarian. I don't know about you guys, but whenever I was little, I had a librarian in school. She scared the heck out of me. So, I don't want to be that kind of a librarian anymore. Librarians nowadays, we know that we have to connect to the community. We have to connect to the people, because when I worked at Greene County, I was out shaking hands and I was out putting yard signs asking you guys to vote for that levy. I know how important it is to create lifelong learners and library users, because my job at that time in Greene County depended on that levy passing. So I know how important it is, and I really, really, I know that getting the kids that have too, is it's the first time that they're going to encounter librarians, some of them. And I get them, and I sink my little nails into them, and I love them, so. But I run the library like it's a project-based learning, kind of an experiment. I really think that when the kids get the books and they read the information, I love to have them apply it. So a couple months, or a couple weeks ago, I was out hiking, so I gathered up some fossils and brought them in, and we have a huge fossil table. I use magnifying glasses so the kids can read the books and apply the information that they learn about in real life. I have a high student involvement. I do not get a lot of parent volunteers in the library. I think I have two that are pretty committed to me. And I shelve and work with about 1,000 books a week that come in and out of my library. So I like to focus more on the kids and doing a lot of fun projects for them. So in order to balance my time, I have developed a training plan for my parent volunteers as well as my kid volunteers. I have fourth and fifth graders that come into the library, and they go through training with me, just like the adults do. But the funny thing is that the kids do a lot better. But they're a little bit more trainable than the adults, because, you know, the adults are ingrained, but the little guys, I can get them young and start them out. I said before that I really want to create lifelong library users. I know how important it is. I have a lofty little goal with these guys too. When I get them, I want to create a more informed citizenry too. That is like my lofty thing with these guys. I want them to be able and be comfortable in searching for information themselves. I want to develop critical thinking skills with these guys. I don't want them to watch TV and take that as gospel. I want them to take a little bit of information and research it themselves and draw their own conclusions. And I want to promote a love of reading. So with the project-based learning, I focus on the critical thinking skills, collaboration, and communication. Sometimes, whenever the kids sit in class for a long time, they are able to work together or cooperate or collaborate. And in the library, I hate to say it, but I have the best job there, and I love it. So, because I get to do really fun stuff with these guys. So, and we develop these things. It's amazing what you would see whenever the kids get together and they talk. I've seen some really amazing little light bulbs go off while kids have Hollywood. It's cool. With the student involvement, I try to follow the three R's that we have at Valley as being respectful, responsible, and resourceful. I train these guys like crazy. So I have kids here who are talking about training. Is anybody talking about training? Who's my training person? Come up, young lady. I did not pay her to do this either.
Today I'm going to be talking about the training we have to do to work in the library. The first thing we learned about are the fiction books, the books that are real. And then we learned about everybody books, the books that everybody can read. And then we learned about the Dewey Decimal System, the books that are real. And we learned how to check teachers and students out with books. My favorite part of helping out in the library is sitting with Tommy every day.
Okay, that gets me in the feels, thank you. All right, so lifelong library users. Like I said, I want to make, the library is not just about books. The library is about information. We have computers. We use like different computer programs. Sometimes, like last year at the end of the year, I took the kids on a virtual zoo trip to the San Diego Zoo, and we watched pandas and polar bears. I want them to feel like the information is accessible to them and that it's not out of their reach. And just because they're kids, it doesn't mean they can't learn or that they shouldn't have access to it. All right, and of course, I want to promote a love of reading. Like I said, I am a newfangled librarian. When these guys come into the class, into my library, They know that they're respected. They know that they're cared about. And I try really hard to teach them how to find their own books and to be resourceful. So I also follow a lot of professional librarian blogs, and I read. I'm a big, fat nerd. So when I go home, I read about library stuff. I know it's really exciting. But one of the things that is up and coming in the library world is makerspaces. And I have decided that I can't afford a 3D printer, which I'd really love to have. Blink, blink. But anyway, did that work? So what I have done, I've created what I call explorer spaces. So I have used the fossils with that. I also, I have the kids very involved in this library. So if you look at that, the thing on the left that has the rocks and the shark's teeth, that's for the kids in the school. I've asked kids from the school to come in and to bring stuff and to show what they have. And what I do too is I teach them that librarians are not just about books. Those little white pieces of paper that are on that's on the articles, I pretend like we're archivists, and I teach them how to archive things. We kind of pretend like we're in a museum, and I show them exactly what to do. And if you ever come into my library, which I hope to see you guys there sometime soon, we have lots of artwork that in the library that the kids have done. There is a professional library blog that I follow that had this on there, and she's like, oh, it's awesome, it's $60. So I'm not going to spend $60 on one coloring sheet, so I went to Staples and got an architectural copy made, and it was $250. So, and also I do it sometimes for the teachers for stress relief. Like, they have this pretty little peacock that they've been working on. They'll come in, like if we have meetings and stuff, or if the kids are listening to a program or something like that, I will let the teachers go up there and just doodle a little bit for stress relief. And it's beautiful. And the kids, I try to involve the kids with everything. I put black construction paper, it's super simple, on the ends of the bookcases, give them chalk and let them go at it. And this was one of our author visits that we had last year from Michelle Nelson Schmidt. She writes the Jonathan James and the What If Monster. She is fabulous, by the way. And we kind of decorated the library, and I'm sorry, those beavers, I'll tell you what, I turned mine into a unicorn. All right, so there is, last year we read The Magic Finger by Roald Dahl. And I'm sorry, but not sorry for all the glitter that came home with their children because their fingers were red. Not sorry at all, because I love glitter. On the left-hand side, you'll see what looks like an aquarium and its computer parts. This was one of the coolest things that we did last year. It's so weird. IT gave me some old CPUs that were really, really old, and I gave the kids screwdrivers and things like that, and we took those things apart. Please, I took off the power pack so that nobody was electrocuted. I did do that. You would not believe the kindergarteners came in there, and they were having a blast with this. But the coolest thing to see was that one day this group of kindergartners, and this little girl, she's always like really quiet and shy, but she led this little group. And she was telling these people, okay, now you're going to do this, and now you're going to do this. So it was really cool to see her have an opportunity to lead, whereas, you know, usually she's just sitting there and she's really, really proud. So I thought that was really awesome. On the right-hand side, a couple weeks ago, I watched this video called Kane's Arcade, and it's about this little boy in East LA, and who went to work with his dad, who owned a junkyard store or a junkyard place, and he was really bored. So in the front of the store, he took his dad's old used boxes and created an arcade. Well, you know, it's LA, so there was a filmmaker involved. He made this film, and I highly recommend watching this. It will make you cry. It gets me every time. It started from this little kid using boxes to make an arcade, and then this filmmaker came along it just went all the way around the world. So now, I forget, I think it's called the Imagination Foundation, and like 62 countries are involved, and there's lots of states and schools that are involved with this. So I issued my kids a challenge, and oh my goodness, it was, I'm really a spur of the moment kind of person, and I didn't think this was going to take off, but we had so many participants that my library looks crazy, but it's okay. It was pretty amazing, and I have some examples up here too. Oh, would you like to talk about your example?
This is my robot. I have not made it up.
But it was super cute. This I have in the very front of the library because I think it's so awesome. I cannot believe when Lindsay brought it into the library. Yeah, my mouth just, I had no words other than just to grab her and hug her. So, yeah, it was really cool. And if you notice, like, Lindsay, you're a fifth grader, right? That right there, that's like a kindergartner, first grader. We had everybody participating in this. It was so awesome. And they were so proud of the stuff that they created. There's a couple more examples. The foosball table is super cool. We get a chance to look at it. All right, ladies, who's doing the string? I set out on my tables a couple of activities for the kids to do after we check out books. I try to keep them occupied as much as possible. And this is one of the most popular things. This book is never checked out, so I thought, oh, I'm just gonna sit on my table and see what happens. I've already gone through two big balls of twine. The kids, I know this sounds so simple, but they absolutely adore and love these things. So, but also, if you notice, like, they have to use critical thinking skills in order to do this stuff. So I don't just lay stuff out there. I give it a lot of thought, and the kids love this. So do you want to show them something?
Sure.
Okay.
So I have a long piece of string. Just wrap it around my hands and put my fingers through. Does anybody want to come up and
share their experiences. Savannah's gonna come up and talk about kind of what they do when they come in to help the reshelf folks.
Almost every day after recess, I come in and help the librarian shelf books. I get some books from the cart and look at the book spines and shelf them. And it's fun because this time turns on the radio and we dance while we shelf books.
We do not dance.
So you were going to talk about a few things that you really enjoyed when you are finished checking out books.
I like looking at the fossils because they're really neat, and I like how she gives us a lot of options to pick from after we're done. Like coloring, she gives us an option to color. We can look at fossils, we can do the string game, and that's pretty much it. And
and we have Emily, who is going to share with her cardboard challenge arcade games.
So mine is a basketball game, and there's a marble inside that you have to kind of bounce the box to get the marble into the net.
So as you can see, I mean, there's so many different activities and so many options for the kids, and it's just a place instead of, you know, them going in, sitting down, you know, listening to a, you know, a 10-minute book and, you know, then checking out a book and leaving. They have so much more interaction, and, you know, that 30 minutes or, you know, is not just them walking around finding a book and leaving. If they, you know, critical thinking skills and finding things, like with the strings, you know, today at lunch, you know, I had, you know, about 5 or 6, here, put your hand here, and they would do it, and then put your hand here, and what do you think's going to happen, and, you know, just, you know, what if we put our hand in this part of the strings instead of, you know, in the center? So, I mean, it's just all of those type of thought processes and skills that, you know, like Ms. Tony said, you know, the book was never checked out, but she put it on the table and put some string there, and now, you know, we've got string all over the building. So it's just, you know, great. And, I just did a presentation to the staff Tuesday about project-based learning and how, you know, with the museum grants, right, that, you know, the elementaries are starting to plan for is based on project-based learning. And so, you know, it's just when she started doing the hardware challenge and, you know, those type of things, it's just, she did that without even knowing that, you know, that's the direction that we were really, that we're heading towards as a district. So she was kind of already getting the kids excited. And I mean, there are boxes and boxes and boxes of projects all over the library. And you saw parents carrying them in, you know, in the morning and things like that. So it's just a great thing for, you know, Ms. Tawny, just to have that insight and really push it even before we start that initiative. So we're very lucky to have her, and you know, thank you for allowing us to, you know, kind of highlight something that's very very special about Valley.
Organization in Dayton, and project, I'm raising money to help buy shoes for underprivileged students, K-12. And because Shoes for Shoeless receives bulk discounts, we can get shoes for $10 a pair. And we're also collecting brand new shoes and brand new socks with, so that students can receive brand new shoes. I'm doing this project because I noticed a need at school because I was just looking around and I saw quite a few students didn't have very good shoes on, so I was like, it would be a good idea for him to. And so my goal for the project is to raise $5,000 by November 15th so that students have good shoes for winter. My other goal is to collect 500 pairs of socks by November 20th so that they can be given out with the shoes. And then I would like to get approval from the board to collect donations at schools. For example, the Beavercreek High School Fall Play, or some band concerts, or other examples. I don't know what else there is. And then approval to ask help from the school PTOs. And then I would need the board to contact Shoes for the Shoeless to coordinate who gets the shoes, because not everybody would be getting the shoes because not everybody needs the shoes. And I would also be asking permission to get to set up days that I can drop the shoes off and where, what schools I can donate. So how the public can donate is donating now, cash only. Shoes for the Shoeless doesn't want to get checks unless it's a one person thing. So with this big project, they don't want any checks. If you do donate shoes, they have to be brand new. Because if they are used, they are already molded to the person's foot that had them before. And if you do donate shoes, they have to be athletic shoes because the students are participating in gym, most likely. And we can't have students participating in gym that have sandals or open-toed shoes because that hurts their feet. And Shoes for the Shoeless does not collect name brand shoes because if they did, students would be fighting over who got those shoes. So we don't want that. One way that you can donate if you do not have cash on you is going to shoesfortheshoeless.org/donate, and it uses PayPal. The link is already set up. If you click donate, it will take you to the website, and all you need to enter is under purpose, indicate Jacob Garrettson's Eagle Scout project, and then just put however much you want to donate. Sets go. And then I have set up times at the Green on October 29th from 3:30 to 9 p.m. and November 4th from 11:30 a.m. to 9 p.m. for people to come and donate. And for more information about my project, you can follow me on Facebook at Jacob Garrison or email me at jacobgarrison1@gmail.com for more information on this project. I also have flyers if anybody would like flyers.
Do you need them with us?
Yes, thank you.
Very welcome. This is a group that I volunteer with. I volunteer with them for 4 or 5 years, I don't know if you know that or not, but thank you for doing this. The need is huge, and for those of you who may not know that, kids that are right here in our district need these shoes. I know people think we're Beavercreek and so we're wealthy, and while that may be true for some, that's not true for all. And there's a lot of kids in this community, as well as surrounding communities, that really, really need these shoes. So what you're doing, I commend you for doing that. It's a huge job. I know my daughter's done shoe drive before, nothing to this scale, but it's a huge need. And what he said about the new shoes versus used, you have to think these kids are probably kids that have never had anything new in their entire life. Nobody's ever given them anything new, and you know, it gives them a feeling of value and worth to receive something that's new and not just another new thing. So that's one of the reasons that they do that. It's a really amazing organization. So if you're not involved, help them get involved with that. If you want to volunteer, you can go on their website too. It's a really amazing project. But I'm sure Mr. Rock will be talking about the logistics of all the approvals.
So that's what I'll do. I will be in contact with Jacob, and we'll coordinate this, and we'll work with the high school as well. We have Mr. Jones back here as well, so we will coordinate. I'll be work towards those goals.
Jacob, thank you for coming to talk to us about this time, because it's such a worthwhile project. I know Hunt does a great job with it. So this is a big project you've taken on, and so worthwhile.
Jacob, if I may add, again, like I've heard my esteemed colleagues say, that the Shoes for Shoeless is a wonderful program. Appreciate you getting involved with that. But in addition to that, you're very close to earning your Eagle Scout Award, and less than 4% of Scouts attain receiving the Eagle Scout Award. So you are definitely to be congratulated for your initiative and your hard work.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jacob. Appreciate it.
Who are the co-players of the year in girls tennis. So congratulations to all of our athletes and our coaches for a great fall.
Green County Career Center, Mr. Bills.
Thank you. Beavercreek Schools is the largest district in the county, and in the past, our participation with Green County Career Center has sometimes been challenged. Folks send a fair number of students. There's a lot of opportunity out there for students. And I want to commend Mr. Otten for already initiating meetings with the superintendent out at the Green County Career Center. It's been very favorable. I think that you're going to discover that the new superintendent actually has been there for a couple of years now at the Career Center, as well as the collaboration that we're now seeing out of Beavercreek City Schools is going to deliver some great results for our kids. And I think that's what it's all about, is to make sure that we are meeting the needs of the students. And he also wanted to make the comment that he appreciates the collaboration that's currently ongoing regarding the aerospace initiative. So thank you very much. The Career Center just came up with a brand new program catalog called Redefining Smart. I brought a copy for all of you at the front table that I'll be happy to pass out. I think you'll discover that the programs, it's a really a nice brochure. Unfortunately, I brought five more, but I encourage anybody who'd like to look at it. But you can get a brief synopsis of all the various programs that are ongoing out at the Career Center. And there are some phenomenal programs. One of the newer programs that's also coming up that's in the special ed area is what we call Career X. And Beavercreek is hoping to participate in that. That's also a brand new program. And then lastly, we do have a newsletter, and I'm going to share the newsletter also. In this case, if I could ask you to pass it down, and hopefully I've got enough there. And I'll be happy to leave any extras. I'll put them out on the table. Last but not least, the Career Center is up on the levee currently, and I happen to notice out in the hallway, actually, they aren't there yet, but they will be. Now, there might be some signs, some yard signs, and would like to invite all of our board members here to be sure and support education and make sure that they put that out on the yard if they would, please. And that concludes my report. Unless there's questions, thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay, we have no questions or comments from the public. So tonight, it's always nice when you're in the recognition. And tonight we have one. And we're going to turn this over to Mr. Speaker.
Thank you very much. Good evening. It is a pleasure to speak before you this evening and spend some time recognizing one of our staff members. Over the past few years, we've done our retirement recognitions a little bit differently than we had in the past. But after talking with cabinet members and Superintendent Otten, we determined we want to bring our recognition back to the formal board meetings rather than a special presentation. And so we're going to start that tonight. We'll be doing those recognitions in the months in which the individual is retiring at the end of the month. And this evening, we're fortunate enough to recognize Ms. Deborah Lucenti, who is an intervention specialist at Beavercreek High School. Deborah, if you come up and stand up here with me for a few moments. This evening, Deborah, when the board takes action to accept a resignation for the purpose of retirement, and at the same time that they accept that resignation, they adopt a resolution. And I'd like to read that resolution to you this evening. And then I'm going to invite Mrs. Link and Mr. Jones up to say a few words. So, you actually submitted your letter, I think, last spring. And so at that board meeting when they adopted, this is the resolution that goes along when they accept the resignation. So at the meeting held by the Beavercreek Board of Education, the following resolution was adopted. Whereas the Board of Education has received notification of the retirement of Deborah Lucenti, and whereas the Board of Education wishes to publicly recognize and commend Mrs. Lucenti for outstanding contribution during her 17 years of dedicated service to Beavercreek City Schools and our community. And whereas Through teaching, the educational and personal lives of countless students have been touched and enhanced by Mrs. Vicente's dedication, counsel, and commitment. And whereas she leaves an outstanding teaching and personal record, which will serve as an exemplary model for others that follow. And whereas her presence, influence, and contribution have helped to make our schools a better place. Therefore, be it resolved that the Beaver Creek Board of Education does hereby accept with regret the retirement resignation of Mrs. Deborah Lucenti and publicly expresses to her its sincere appreciation for your outstanding career in our schools. We wish you health, happiness, and a long, active, and contented retirement. Mrs. Lucenti, on behalf of the Board of Education, I'd like to ask Mr. Jones and Mrs. Link to come up. We would like to present you with a copy of that resolution this evening, a plaque to honor your years of service with Beaver Creek City Schools, and an activity pass so you can visit us and come back and support and see the great things that our students continue to do. Congratulations very much. Mr. Jones, Mrs. Link.
Good evening. I'm honored and humbled to be standing up here with Mrs. Lucenti tonight. I truly believe those who serve students and communities for more than four decades, I'm glad to register with you for four decades, I've lost his turn.
17 years, he's just here to cry.
I consider that rarefied air. You know, when I look at my own, I'll call it my own mortality in this business, when I think about four decades, that's incredible. In the 17 months I've been here, the impact the Dev has had on our building is very, very clear. Absolutely. Stellar reputation precedes her and the work that she does with our students on a daily basis. In an era where many are done when their date arrives, Dev is to be celebrated for that commitment to her students and our schools. Some highlights from her career that started in California. She started with Dayton Christian School in 1982. In 1989, she transitioned over to the Dayton Public Schools. We were fortunate in 1999 that she selected us to come join our team and serve our students and our community. At the end of this month, she will be finishing her career with us. Mrs. Lucenti is a graduate of Colorado State College and completed her Master's of Education work at Xavier in 1992. And with all that training, provided exemplary service to our kids, to our community. For that, I'm eternally grateful.
I'm going to tell you a bunch of stuff you already this has been my first year, just completed my first year at Beaver Creek, and as a special ed supervisor with Debbie, and we started out the year with a lot of IEP meetings. Debbie a lot in the first quarter, and Debbie has worked most recently with our 11th and 12th grade students and has done just been more of like a coach and a facilitator, taught our study skills classes most recently, and as I've told Debbie before, I really have appreciated her work with our juniors and seniors. We really do focus a lot on transition and helping our career and college-bound kids get ready for that next step after high school, and Debbie's just much the transition of need. So certainly asked just in our last quarter of this year, besides helping with our seniors who are struggling with the OGT to pass the OGT, to also kind of counsel the rest of our intervention specialists and help with those transition plans for post-secondary. One thing that I really like about Debbie's and then a lot of IEP meetings here and in other districts is that a lot of teachers in meetings, particularly with parents, will either get into the habit of sugarcoating things for our kids with special needs, or go into lecturing mode to the point where I know the kid is only hearing, you know, that teacher from Charlie Brown, that wah, 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 wah. I love working with Debbie because that doesn't happen. So she's very honest to the point, professional, and the kids know that she has their best interests in heart and is not giving them just lip service, that she is going to coach and facilitate, help them find the data to get the information they need to make good choices about the future. So that's just in the last year, and Debbie's been with us a lot longer than that. So I had to consult some other staff for some more information on Debbie's history with us. Found that in 1999, when we came to Beavercreek, you shared a very small room with four other staff and worked out of that to help our students with proficiency in special ed. Moved a couple rooms over the years, and in 2003, shared a classroom with another staff member, and all the teachers that have shared stories about Debbie, the resounding thing is that Debbie's very organized. Debbie will do anything for anybody, and so organized that, this is great, just as a special educator, that you actually kept a calendar for every single kid of all things that you worked on. Daily with every single kid, just excellent documentation, just dedication to our kids. Debbie is known for her strength in math and just working with other teachers and helping kids get the things that they need. And most overall, just very clear sense that you are loved and respected by your colleagues, and your devotion to kids is obvious. And I am definitely going to miss you come November 1st. You've been a good support to me as well, and to all of our staff. And so in closing, classy, professional, and low digits. That's 70%.
For the collections in March of 2017. So We put that on the ballot as soon as we could. It was no new millage, but it was renewed. And it brings in $18,517,000, $17,600, so $18.5 million. And that has to be renewed about every 5 years. It's an emergency levy. That's a lot of money to have to be renewed. It's pretty significant to our organization. It's almost half of our salaries. So that's something that we talk about because we have two levies plus the PI levy that we have to renew regularly, which means we have to go back to the voters just to keep the level of revenue that we're getting today or at the point in time that was initially voted in. So what that does is that keeps us on the ballot all the time. And another thing we have to renew then next fall, or May of 2017, this May, it'll be the new millage, and it brings in $10.4 million, or almost half of our benefits. And it's about 6.3 mils, and it will be put on the May ballot. The board approves that in January to put that on. And again, that'll be no new millage, just to keep, you know, the same revenues that we have right now today. So this graph shows that if we, for whatever reason, wouldn't pass our levy renewal in May, we would have positive money through fiscal year 2019. And then this next chart shows the exact same data, except if we do pass the levy, if it is renewed, then we can have a positive balance through fiscal year 2020. And this is some of the things we've already been talking about. This is really not anything new. We talked about this in May. We've been lucky. Our five-year forecast, we came out very close to what we had projected our expenditures in our October forecast last year. So by the end of, which was June 30th of 2016, our five-year forecast was in very close alignment with our actual expenditures. So all we did was then add another year onto our five-year forecast. This ending cash balance shows that, again, you know, what we're going to look like if we do not pass our levies, and we would be in dire need in 19 or 20. The ending cash balance with the renewal, the one thing we want to bring our attention to is the orange line on this chart, because that's what we've all agreed upon, that we want to make sure that we have a level of reserves to operate our organization. So in fiscal year 19, we start seeing that we start to dip below the reserve line, and in 20 and 21, we are completely below. So we start looking in terms of needing new money in fiscal year 19 for collection in 20, or fiscal year 18 for collection in 19. Well, why don't we know for sure? Well, there are several variables that are going to impact our five-year forecast that we don't have that information right now. One thing that we don't know about is we have two biennium budgets that the Ohio Department of Education will have to come up with formulas. It depends on a lot of factors on what that state money is going to look like for Beaver Creek City Schools. So those are unknowns, two biennium budgets. Another unknown is our negotiated agreements for this year. We are in the second year of our negotiated agreements with our unions, so we know what salaries are going to be this year, but going forward, those are some things we don't know, and that's a large percentage of our expenditures. Our tax rates have been staying pretty steady. We're only up about 0.75%. The bulk of our tax rates or our tax revenue comes in from residential, the red part of our pie chart there, and the commercial is about 25%, or the purple part. We have 1% in industrial, 1% in agricultural, and 2% in public utilities. So overall, we're going to be funded on our local level by residential and commercial. The funds that we bring in for revenue mainly is the local money, 75, almost 76%. And we bring in state sources of about 24%. So the levies that we pass on the local level are significant, and they matter. The state sources, which is only 25%, those are the dollars that we won't know a lot about and then, unless we know what happens in the next two biennium budgets. But these do assume the collection of the $10.4 million levy or the 6.3 mils that we have coming up in May. So we are a formula district. We are on the formula. We have been on the cap before. We, you know, because the formula changes, we're right at that level. But once we had all day kindergarten and we expanded, it put us into the formula. We have an addition of students with that all day kindergarten, and that's what bumped us up to the formula. Our ADN may go up more depending on with the enrollment increases that we get, whether those are students that are already within our ADN, meaning they're going to a charter school or a private school that they're already counted, or if they're new people coming into the area, period. One thing that we have noticed a little bit when we've had a little subgroup working on FTEs or students internally, one of the things we have been noticing is, you know, we do have the growth around the area that we're seeing, the new builds. So we are seeing that we're bringing children in at the lower grade levels. There's been a little bit of a bubble there, but we've also noticed a dip at the high school, like the graduation numbers are down. So overall, we're kind of staying steady. Over this five-year forecast, we're not seeing a great deal of increase like some may think when you look around and see all the new builds. The people who have children who have been through the district and have graduated are still staying, but they don't have students in our district. So the new people coming in the new builds, it just brings in the students that we are losing at the high school level. So that's just a long-winded way to say we're just kind of staying steady. And we've had some experts do the enrollment studies, and that's what they're seeing as well. I think we talked about the biennium budgets and that we need to pass the levy, so those are our challenges. The wages and benefits that we have to look at, we're at about 82% of our expenditures because we're a service-oriented organization. And right now, what we have factored in the forecast is the 2.75% raises plus our steps for this year, because that's what we had last year and this year in our negotiated agreement. To project out in the future, since we're trying to look at when will we need new levy money, what does the bottom line look at, we try to put in there something that's reasonable, even though we haven't negotiated yet, because you have a bit of bargain in good faith. That's the law when we are looking at the expenses for salaries. Right now we have about 2% projected in for pay raises annually plus steps. What we're seeing when we look at the OSBA management letter that comes out, we're seeing what other districts are settling at, and it's around, if you took an average, it was about an average of 2%. Some districts higher, some lower, depending on what was going on with their benefit plan and all these other indicators. But for the purpose of projecting, so that we could still kind of try to do some scenarios as to when we need levy money, how much is our bottom line we're going to be impacted, we put in 2%. These are our expenditures on an annual basis and how our expenses are going. You can see that, you know, our revenue is staying pretty steady because we're just doing renewals, which is no new millage or no new money, so you're bringing in the same amount of dollars, but our expenditures are increasing. So that's why long term we will need new money. We cannot sustain our expenditure base if we do not have new money in 18-19, somewhere in there. Depending on what that next biennium budget does for us and what our next negotiated agreement would do. We'll know a little more, but we continue to monitor. In your packets, pages 35 to 53 is where your five-year forecast is in your notes, and the notes to the forecast. On pages 47 to 49 in your board agenda is the salary piece. What you're going to see is we've, since our last levy that we did pass that was new money, there were a lot of promises that were made, and those were noted into the Creek Connections in 2012 and in the fall. We had not passed levies, we had made large cuts, millions of dollars of cuts, then we passed the levy because as we asked the community for additional dollars, we said these are the things we will add back if you pass the levy, and so we've been good stewards of that, we've been faithful, and I continue to put in the five-year forecast notes all those promises that were made and all those promises that were kept, so that when we go to the levy to ask the community for new money, they will see that we have been faithful to what we said we would do. At this point, if there's any questions, I'll be glad to take those.
I was looking at this, and I don't understand at home. So, since one question, since we have to negotiate labor contracts the next year and going forward, how accurate do you think the salary line is, and then how accurate is the bottom line?
Those are a couple of areas that I'm going to continue to monitor, and I'll talk to you about that as we keep going. I would hope that we can say pretty, I'm hoping that that's a pretty accurate picture. Typically, I think that while we need to bargain in good faith, I think we also have to look at what the market is doing as far as negotiated agreements and what other districts are doing, and if they're hovering around 2%, I would think we would be able to stay there. But, you know, we'll know more about that after we get into negotiations and see what it looks like. But obviously, if that 2% number changes up in any way, then your bottom line, of course, is going to go down significantly, and that would impact us needing to do a levy earlier. And we don't have a lot of time to deal with it. The other piece of that is if you cut early, you know, you can get more mileage out of your fiber request. So if you cut smaller, the earlier you cut, you can also pass lower millage levies the earlier you start running levies. So we'll definitely be talking about that.
Okay, and then since the payroll is 82% of the budget, how do you think the unknowns are going to impact the future revenues?
Those are things we just have to continue to monitor. I'm hopeful that our biennium budgets will at least hold us harmless, that they won't reduce revenue on us. That's my hope.
That's a good hope.
I'm hoping. I'm guessing, but I'm hoping.
Thank you. This is incredible. Thank you, guys.
And Mr. Brucker, I'd like to thank you and Ms. Rott for the very detailed report. It's excellent. The 82% of our expenditures going towards salaries and benefits certainly postures us, puts us in a very good position. There are variables, which you spoke very eloquently about, the state funding. We do have two biennial budgets that control, so we kind of take their mercy, plus the negotiated agreements, which I understand as well. I'm sure the community understands we are being very fiscally prudent. We are being good stewards of the taxpayers' dollars. Doing a phenomenal job in that area. And despite that, right now we have a healthy carryover balance, over 60 days true cash value. And because of that, we're in good shape. But I do get nervous when I see in the forecast that we are in deficit spending during this five-year forecast. So that's something that I'm sure you both will be looking at pretty carefully. And of course, hopefully we'll be successful with the renewal levels as well.
Okay, thank you.
School year. What I'd like to talk to the board about is The Ohio Revised Code allows a school district to choose two dates as an entrance date into kindergarten. Those two dates are August 1st and September 30th. So if you look at that, that's a two-month span of time. A lot of districts, I would say most of the districts across the state have gone with the September 30th date, and that is what Beavercreek currently is. What we're starting to see is a shift more towards the August 1st date, and that's for a number of reasons. One is, obviously, you're reducing the number of very young kids that are coming into a kindergarten setting. And our state has been forced into a position of testing. And as adults that work with kids all the time, we have to give our kids the best advantages they can. And a lot of school districts are now starting to take that shift to move that date to an August 1st date, so that we are seeing our kids a little bit older. And maturity of that time really does make a difference. I brought this up, I've heard it just being here just the short time I've been in the district. I've had a number of teachers talk to me about this already, that this is something that they've really wanted to look at for a number of years. I brought it up with our elementary principals about a week and a half ago, and all of them were in agreement that they would like to see this shift. However, when you make a shift like that, you're also impacting families in our community. And families have talked to their kids about starting kindergarten. They have prepared. They are looking, they're excited about their child to move forward into the kindergarten year. So, to be fair to our community and our parents, this is not something that I would recommend we would do overnight. This is something that we need to communicate out to our community so that they're very aware of what this change might be and allow them the opportunity to plan accordingly with their children. So it would be my recommendation to come before the board with policy language. I've given a piece of paper. This would be policy 5112. And this would be language that we would write into this. And you'll notice that the language is written into two separate pieces. One is for the 2017-2018 school year. The 2017-2018 school year just basically maintains what we currently are doing. And one thing I do want to draw your attention to is what it also, it defines not only a kindergarten entrance date, but it also defines a kindergarten and first grade. And one of the reasons I wanted to write that in there is because if you only write that you've attended kindergarten, then we have the opportunity where families could actually go to a private kindergarten, their child could attend, and then they could bring them over here. And we really feel strongly that the age is important. It's an important piece. So we would write this that would also be for a student who is 6 years of age on or before September 30th. And Ohio Revised Code allows us to write that age in there as well. Moving into the 18-19 school year, that would make the shift to an August 1st date, and it would also make the shift to an August 1st date for six-year-olds going into first grade as well. Just a little bit of data for you. I asked Kylie to pull up how many kids would this impact with our kindergartners today. We do not have anybody with an August 1st birthday. We have an August 2nd birthday through September 30th, and it is 50 students, right on the number 50. So 50 students would have been impacted this year if we made this move. So this would be my recommendation to come back with the policy language. I will give that out to you through email, let you review it. But before we went through that work, I really wanted to try to get some feedback. One piece I do want to add for families who say, no, my child is ready. Ohio Revised Code requires all school districts in the state to have an acceleration evaluation committee that is formed within the district. We obviously have that because we're required to. A family could still come in and request early entrance into the schools, and that's a testing protocol that they go through with the committee, and then that committee makes that recommendation. So I say that because hypothetically, let's say we have our 50 students. If 15 of those students, those parents have prepared and they feel their child is ready for kindergarten, we don't want to tell a student they're not ready. So if they want to go through that early entrance, they have the right to do that. They have that right now. So just wanted to bring this forward, really as an item for you to consider, but I would like to move forward with giving you some policy language, present that, and then we would approve that probably in December. And that would give us enough time to really get out to our families what we're doing. So I want to ask if the board has any questions at all about that.
I can see the value in this. I'm just speaking, not on the board, the teacher. And I'm also talking as a parent. Our child had a late September birthday. We kept him out, and we kept him in preschool last year. He had a great time. That, you know, he just was really immature, just really having a great time in preschool. The best gift we ever gave him was putting him in kindergarten at 6 years old. It is the best gift we've ever given our child. And I've shared this with many people during my years as teaching and as a parent. The best advice I was ever given, best advice I could be, and I, you're right, every child, you know, doesn't fit into this mold, but seeing kids by the time they get to third grade or that young age is a real killer by that age, and it's a little late. So this is, I think we're doing a real service, but I think the key here is to educate parents, like I was educated as a parent, because everybody feels their child's ready, and there are kids who are ready, but I really appreciate you bringing this to us.
Somebody with elementary age kids, well, one elementary middle school now. I mean, what we're expected to do when I was in kindergarten is not what they're expected to do now. It's totally different. So I think we're setting them up to be much more successful. They're a little bit older, a little more mature. And I teach at a private preschool now. I know preschool teachers in the audience, I'm sure they would probably concur that most kids really would benefit.
And just to give you a snapshot of the county, there are two districts in the county that are at the August 1st date currently, and the rest of the districts are at September 30th date. So just to let you know.
I do have one question. Should we offer any like early vibes program? I know Centerville schools offer something called early vibes for kids that are in that bubble age group. Sure. And I don't know if that's something that we could explore. Maybe that's offered at preschool, you know, that like Kinder Start or something, like transition program for families who might feel like they need a little bit more than half-day preschool.
We actually had a program in Fairfield that if we went to kindergarten, if you were a student that felt that the teachers felt as though you would benefit from another year, it was called transitions, it was smaller class sizes, it was a full-day program. So it was basically the grade between kindergarten and first grade. So it was trying to transition first. Those students ended up being some of our top students when they had a nice.
We used to have a program like that. And then, you know, let us fail.
Yeah, that's exactly
that way. I'm going to tell you, that day was a very sad day to get that program on because it wasn't such a benefit to our students. And they just needed that extra year.
Sure.
Sure. Child or two, you have to stick to that. That was the K, yep, the K plus. Yep, it was an incredible program. That would be such a benefit, something like that, to bring it back to the neighborhood. But I'm just telling you, it was just an amazing program. And really, it was for the benefit of the kids. And some of these kids just needed that extra year, and they were just, so yeah, that was a great program.
Okay. Well, I will proceed and present policy language to you via email, and then that'll be information that we can present as a first reading and approve it later. The next item I'd like to share with the board, I just want to give you a brief update where we currently stand with. We have three straight A grants, but probably the biggest one that we're looking at is our STEM JED. So late last week, after this has gone through our attorney and some revisions, we had sent out a request for proposals. I have given each of you a copy of the request for proposal that went out on the 13th, so a week ago. And we have requested that the RFP is returned by November 7th by noon, and those are going to come to Mr. Thompson. We are meeting on Monday with SHP Leading Design. They're the architect that has allowed us to do some pro bono work through them. And Jeff Parker will be out here to look at interior and exterior design to get some numbers and firm up the numbers that we currently have. And also want to let the board know we've been engaged in conversations with Wright State and Clark State, and actually today I received an email from Wright State, so they're all up to speed with where we currently stand. And it is my intent to come before the board in November with numbers and figures of where we see the project currently standing. But I want to give you an update on that because we've not had an opportunity to share that with you yet. So, does the board have any questions about this agenda at this point?
Is there a date that ODE has for, in terms of accepting the grant
money? We have to provide information via their website by November 1st. That information you can fill in because it is information about what processes are we currently doing. So we actually met today to go through that with Dr. Sizemore, and she's going to be filling in with the RFP going out and the information tied to that. So none of that impacts the money or the acceptance of the money at this point. So it's just it's more for them to gather information. Yep. Okay, the last item I have is urgent necessity, and that relates to the gymnasium floor at Coy Middle School, as you recall. We had an HVAC glycol leak there, so I'm going to ask Mr. Thompson if he wouldn't mind addressing the board on this topic. He was the one who has done the work to get us where we're at this point.
Thank you, Superintendent. Members of the board, as I know you're aware, we had a catastrophic leak to our HVAC system at Coy Middle School. Because of that, we have a need for a resolution declaring urgent necessity before go to the standard bidding procedures. On the morning of Friday the 16th, when our custodian reported to Coy to unlock the building, he found a glycol water mixture that leaked onto the floor at Coy and Trayvine right around the gym and commons area. It's estimated that there was approximately 1,000 gallons of this mixture that had traveled across the floor and also into our gymnasium. Besides the mess to clean up, it also left our HVAC system in a non-functioning condition. This resulted in us canceling school for the day at both Boyd and Trayvine as our crews worked to clean up the mess and get the HVAC back up and running. Our teams worked extremely hard that Friday and over the weekend to get the building back to school ready for Monday morning. The gymnasium was the only thing that was not school ready on Monday. We were advised from our insurance company to immediately contact the drying company to get drying equipment onto the floor as soon as possible. We worked with restoration resources and had equipped on the floor as early as that Saturday morning. We closely monitored the situation and left this equipment on the floor for 2 weeks to try to save the floor. Our insurance carrier, Travelers through the EPC, and four separate flooring companies were contacted to come in to look at our floor, offer recommendations, and submit comparable proposals. The recommendation is to replace the floor. Cincinnati Floors, the Ohio Floor Company, Axis Interior Systems, and the Final Floor all came out to evaluate our situation and have provided us quotes for a new comparable floor. The Final Floor has provided the best proposal and they can begin work as early as Monday the 24th with approval of this resolution. They anticipate it will take 3 to 4 weeks to complete the work. The demolition work, taking out the old floor, conducted mostly on second shift to minimize disruption to the middle school. Once completed, no one should know the difference. It's this very similar floor, same graphics, everything should be the same. This is part of our insurance claim with that leak. We have a $5,000 deductible. Any questions?
Thank you. Thanks for you. And that concludes Superintendent Report.
So watching the business, and motion is second to approve which is block on the employment salary changes and leave of absence and terminations. Approval of type 6 Transportation Planning Act, approval of resolution declaring an urgent necessity exists and authorizing the execution of an agreement outside the competitive bidding process for replacement of the gymnasium floor at Coyne Middle School, and approval of 2016-17 transportation type 4 reimbursement.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion.
I just would like to comment on item B and D, type 4, type 6 transportation. Type 4 is your typical reimbursement. Those are for students who may live outside of our attendance area, or they may be attending a school where there might be two kids on a bus, so it's not practical for us to use a bus to get that student there, so we give them a set amount. Type 6 is very different, and you may not see this again, but this is for a student who is a special needs student, who we have the option of either contracting through a special service, or we can reimburse the parent for that transportation. And that is set at a mileage rate for how many miles back and forth that is. So that is what type 6 is, and we are moving forward with a reimbursement to the parent for that transport. And those make practical sense financially for the district to do that. So I just wanted to comment on those two items, and that concludes the business items for me.
Thank you. Can we have our announcements? Oh, sorry. We need one. Please, thank you.
Mr. Morrison?
Yes.
Ms. Hunt?
Yes.
Ms. Rabada?
Yes.
Mr. Taylor?
Yes.
Motion carries.
Now we can do announcements. Thank you. It's hard to believe it's the end of the first grading period. There will be early dismissal on October 21st. There will be no school K-3 only conferences on October 28th. Election day, go out and vote November 8th. And the next Board of Education meeting is November 17th, right here at 6:30. Board comments. Mr. Taylor.
Mr. Taylor. I think it's a little wonder that Beavercreek is a preeminent community in the Dayton area. I think it really just stands as a measure of the quality of our teachers, the success of our sports, the engagement of our students, which we just witnessed with the display here from Valley Elementary, and the community support. So just very, very proud to be part of the community and the schools that represent it.
Thank you. Mr. Morrison.
I just like to congratulate everyone involved on a very successful beginning for the first quarter for our school year. Obviously, I like to see that financially we're in very good shape. Love to see that enrollment is up, the excellent programs that we have for young people. So keep up the good work.
Awesome. I'm just glad to see lots of people in the seats earlier, anyway, I guess. We must have lost the excitement level. But it was neat to see the kids. That's always the best part of the meeting, is having kids come up here and talk about it, because they get to do it every day. So for those staff members who already left, you'll see on video later. Thank you for what you do with all of those kids.
And the School Bus Appreciation Week, and we are so fortunate to have the caring drivers that we have. I personally, right there, I'm taking my kids out to the buses, and these drivers are calling each child my name, they're welcoming them, it's amazing, little treats for them on holidays, I'm like, seriously, I mean, it's just amazing to see the love they have for these kids. I mean, that is a really hard job. Not me, no. But I mean, when you think about it, I've said this before, they're the first person our kids see in the morning and the last person they see at night. These people make a difference in their life. So, to all our bus drivers, please know how much we appreciate it and how thankful we are that you work for your great city school. I would not want that job. It's amazing. And the other thing is, I would like to thank all the people that were involved in the homecoming parade, participants in it, and thank the community for coming out and supporting it. That was a great, that was a really great parade. See all those people out there, all those kids in the parade. It was so exciting. So I'd like to thank everybody involved and the community. And that takes us into the last item, and I'm going to need a motion in a second for us to go into executive session for appointment, employment, dismissal, discipline, promotion, demotion, or compensation of public employees for Ohio Revised Code 121.22G1 and security arrangements per Ohio Revised Code 121.22G6, and know that there will be no action taken tonight.
So moved.
Sorry.
Ms. Hunt? Yes. Mr. Taylor?
Yes.
Mr. Morrison?
Yes.
Ms. Cornell?
Yes.
Motion carries.
Thank you, everybody, for coming tonight. Thank you, Valerie.